Hello, welcome to the Satellite MarketCast podcast, where we feature key executives from leading satellite companies worldwide, talk about their company, their careers, industry trends, and other insights on the exciting satellite communication industry. I'm your host, Virgil Labrador, Editor-in-Chief of Satellite Markets and Research, inviting you to another informative podcast with our featured guest today. Well, welcome everybody to our Global Pandemic edition of the Satellite MarketCast podcast. And our guest today is Vagan Shakgildyan. He's the president and CEO of UHP Networks. It's a company that we've been following over the years. Usually at this time of the year, we meet at the IBC and we get an update from Vagan. The IBC has gone virtual this year, so we're also doing this audio podcast. So Vagan, welcome to this podcast.
Hello, Virgil. Great to be in this session with you. Thank you for inviting us. It's a regular fixture in the calendar. September, we're having these meetings. So very, very glad to have this session with you.
How are you doing so far, Vagan? How are you and your company coping with the global pandemic?
We're doing okay. It's a global challenge. These are the times unlike any others. I don't need to tell you. I mean, all over the world, we have a global outlook, right? All the players in the SATCOM industry, the industry is very, very global, like the ubiquitous coverage of the satellites that we're working with. And so we're seeing all over the world, obviously, lockdowns, quarantines, kind of seismic shifts in some of the industries. Mm-hmm. That said, we at UHP Networks have been fortunate that we are a growing company. We've been going for more than 10 years, but we're still, our growth is very dynamic and very pronounced. So in that sense, we have been fortunate that actually our sales revenues continue to grow. We finished at the end of April our fiscal year with 24% growth in revenues and significant growth in profitability as well. So which means that our customers keep placing orders. But of course, at the same time, we're looking into the future with a certain concern. We have to work harder to make sure that the orders are coming and need to continue innovating. Of course, that underpins our success. Mm-hmm. Everything we do, technology innovation, we can get nowhere without it. Our supply chain has been very reliable. We have a distributed supply chain. We're manufacturing different parts of the world. And so there was no interruption in our operations whatsoever. We never shut down any of our offices. I'm talking to you now from our Montreal office here in Quebec, Canada. Very vibrant operation, never stopped working. So we're continuing, we're steaming ahead, we're going ahead at full speed.
Right. How many sites, just for our benefit of our listeners who are not familiar with your company, how many, you install networks, right? So how many sites have you installed already at this point?
Well, it's not easy to count that. I mean, we probably have shipped in excess of 50,000 remote terminals out there. But what is more important is that we have more than 400 networks installed. We're counting we don't count the CPC-based smaller networks. We're counting larger TDMA-based hubs. And that's more than 400 networks out there. And many of them are in service for a number of years, very successful installations. And the networks vary in size also. I mean, maybe years ago when we started, anything above 10 sites looked like a sizable network to us. Now imagine we have dozens of networks with more than 1,000 remotes, and our largest network now has 18,000 remotes.
18,000.
Yeah, that's a...
And you announced just a deal even during this pandemic, right? The Orion in Australia?
Oh, yes. Well, that is not the network that I was talking about. That network is also in Asia Pacific, and it is a maritime network. Orion is a trusted partner of ours. They're of course part of IPSTAR group of companies, and they have both maritime services that they support and provide using our products. Some of them are high-speed trunking, like the Spirit of Tasmania ferries connected using UHP product. But also in that announcement that you're referring to, Virgil, I believe they're talking about kind of broadcast connectivity and where they are taking out some legacy technologies with actually some of the vendors established for many, many years with them on worldwide. And they see merit in our technology such that they're replacing those legacy installations with UHP. And that's what that press release that they issued is all about.
Right. And also, I understand you've also done some work in the emergency service provision, you know, during this pandemic, right?
Well, it's definitely something that has been going on. Satellite technology, as you know, has traditionally been used by emergency services worldwide. So yes, some field hospitals in the U.S., health services in the U.S. Certainly are run by, are supported by satellite operators, network operators who use UHP technologies. Orbital Media in Texas is one that springs to mind. Where now we did any press releases about that, but that is fine. It's something that needs to be done, not for the sake of press releases, but for the sake of the community, society as a whole. And of course, there was work that we did in Europe, our partners did in Europe and Northern Italy, just at the start of the pandemic when things were really tough. Out there in those worst affected regions.
Right. Now, Bagan, you know, your company installs networks, right, all over the world. You said that you're operating and you haven't ceased operations during this pandemic. But how has that affected the restrictions and all that? Has that affected your installations and delivery of the networks that you provide?
Yes, most definitely. Most definitely, as my future colleague Lou Dubin pointed out in one of these podcasts, we can plan networks and engineering documentation, PowerPoint slides or spreadsheets as much as we want. But at the end, it all boils down to delivering and installing those networks. And you're absolutely right, Virgil. There are massive restrictions. Well, start from Canada, where I am now. Every person returning from overseas travels is subject to 2 weeks quarantine. So even before we start talking about restrictions that exist in various overseas locations, and they do exist. From what I understand, there are massive restrictions, closed borders in many countries. China is one example where they revoked all the visas, from what I heard, but there are other examples too. So what we have done in a constructive way, because our business continues nonstop, we have engaged local partners and the design of our equipment and solution is such that the hardware is very, very simple. The actual installation can be done, I wouldn't say by an unskilled person, but with very basic skills in terms of kind of electronic equipment installation and wiring. And then our local partners do that part of work. They act as our eyes, our hands in the field, our boots on the ground, if you will. And then we take it over from there. We have 24/7, two actually 24/7 network operation centers or support centers. And we basically configure things remotely and support the customers in installation and commissioning remotely. That is our solution to that challenge. So as long as the customer teleports remain open, And that is not always the case. Let's be very clear. There are curfews and whatnot in some of the locations worldwide. But as long as those locations, those operations remain open, we can support those remotely with the help of those local partners.
Right. Now, you mentioned Lou Dubin. He was the VP of Product Management of Comtech EF Data. And we just did a podcast with them. Your company merged with Comtech EF Data last year, right? I mean, it was announced last year.
Yes,
indeed. How's that process going?
Right. Well, that process is going well. It's taking longer than expected. Indeed, it was announced in late November last year. The process, like I say, it's taking longer than expected, mainly due to the pandemic and various factors associated with it. So the actual process will probably take a couple more months or something like that, but certainly we expect to complete it by end of this calendar year 2020.
Yeah, and if once this merger is finalized, how do you see your company in, as part of Comtech EF Data?
Right, so we will be, so of course the acquiring entity is Comtech Telecommunications, the corporation itself, but yes, the plan is we are pretty well aligned now with Comtech EF Data division. We will be part of that operation out of Tempe, Arizona. It's a great match. It's a great match of both technologies and teams and in many other senses, customer bases and so on. Our Comtech EF Data and Comtech Telecommunications as a whole is obviously one of the legends of our industry with a great reputation and longevity and a lot of excellent products and great teams worldwide and their head office. So the way it's going to work is that Comtech, EF Data have their networking platform known as Heights, and that is of course best in class. SCPC dynamic assignment DAMA based platform that serves high end from the throughput point of view applications, whereas our platform is one of the best in many respects, so we consider it the best in terms of TDMA efficiency, and this is what is required with low to medium throughput services and network solutions, and certainly for large scale networks, the kind of networks that I was mentioning in the previous part of our conversation, Virgil, when we're talking about more than 1,000 sites, several thousand sites, when we're talking about networks of that kind, broadband access, and many others, the TDMA technologies are definitely the best fit. And Comtech EF Data recognizes that, and from the product point of view, we're expecting to merge the product lines into which will offer best-in-class SCPC as well as TDMA-based solutions.
Right, right. Now, moving forward, Vagan, how has your business changed, or have you changed any focus in terms of market segments or anything as a result of this pandemic? How do you see your company now in the next year or so?
Right. Well, I wouldn't say that we changed our focus. Our focus remains the same. It's not that, well, most of the industry, I think, is still focused on the same things in terms of medium to long term. Maybe some players changed their kind of short term focus, but we didn't even have to do that. We have been we had little exposure to little to no exposure to the segments that were impacted in a detrimental fashion, such as commercial connectivity, in-flight connectivity for commercial aviation. We had, again, little to no exposure to the cruise ship industry. In that regard, we don't have to change focus or anything like that. So we're continuing with the developing, progressing along our product and business development roadmap. So in other words, what we're doing at Virgil, we are actually, we just released our product release, software release 3.6 with many, many exciting features which benefit mobile networks, the high speed connectivity, 200 megasingle per second, 450 megabit per second DVB-S2X carrier, map-based beam switching, load balancing across the beams, many, many exciting features. I won't go into all the details, but that definitely will benefit maritime networks, will benefit HTS networks, will benefit cellular backhaul networks. And going forward, in the coming months, we will be releasing 3.7 software, which will increase the hub processing density, actually double it, every single module of our hub, which is currently able to process four carriers, will process eight carriers. So which means that our hubs, in certain benchmark examples, will reduce in size by half. Right, which is a tremendous feat if you think about it. If we are currently able to process, have real estate in terms of the rack space in our hubs, 10 to 12 times smaller than competition, then we will take it up another notch. And that's what it's all about. And the current trend of reducing the footprint in terms of physical size of the equipment, it's energy consumption, increasing the processing density, and quite frankly, virtualizing the VSAT infrastructure. Right. These are the key enablers that will propel our business forward and will deliver value to our customers.
Yeah, sounds very, very exciting, actually. You know, those are very great innovations that you're introducing into the market. So I take it you're very bullish about the market going forward.
Well, look, it's we are certainly hopeful that our business will continue to thrive. At the same time, we're concerned, and we're concerned about our business. We're concerned about the industry. We're concerned about society as a whole. We do not exist in a vacuum. We're not immune to the developments that take place in the society around us, right, and all over the world, of course, far from it. So basically, I wouldn't use the word bullish when we describe our outlook, but we are certainly optimistic. We believe that no matter what happens from the world history, the underlying basics are definitely there, and those basics, those fundamentals, you need to fulfill those requirements no matter what. And certainly connectivity in regard to broadband, in regard to delivery of media content, is a key part which basically is needed alongside basic infrastructure requirements such as running water and a kind of staple diet and so on. So we don't see a change there. We don't see that the services that our customers delivering, whether they are monitoring gas and oil pipelines, servicing some drilling rigs, whether they're providing broadband connectivity to communities in the Canadian North, because of the pandemic, those services are going to get canceled somehow or shrunk and so on. We don't think it's going to happen. And it is our role and our mission to deliver excellent services, value for money, something that through innovation, first and foremost, gives delivers excellent price performance ratio, in other words, value to our customers and to the society as a whole.
Right, Bogan. Yeah, I think those are great insights. I think you know, we both have been in the industry a while, you know, and we've seen crises before, and the industry has somehow pulled out of it, you know, or even the tribe where always opens up other opportunities.
Well, it's always a realignment. It's a realignment and a redistribution of emphasis and impact and kind of the driving forces and so on. And of course, some players were kind of focusing in industry in this conversation. So without getting too philosophical, suffices to say that, of course, stronger players, they have somewhat a bigger staying power, right? It's they are able to sustain the volatility associated with events like the pandemic, whereas maybe some of the others are not as well positioned. And you know, it's like weaker projects, the rationale for which wasn't kind of tenuous to start with, those projects disappear. But the stronger projects with a stronger underlying rationale in terms of business and the need in the society, those persist and they just don't go away. People find ways. The creativity of humankind is such, not just in innovation, Moore's law, whatever, but also in terms of ability to sustain basic business operation, to maintain the livelihood of the society, cannot be underestimated. And I'm optimistic in that regard. People will find a way. People will find a way with cope with this. That's what enables us to look into the future with optimism.
Right. Very well said, Vagan. You know, I think your company is also, you know, as an observer and as of the industry, I think your company seems to be very well positioned to face the challenges ahead. You know, you have new products and you're positioned in all the markets, and you have an infrastructure base that you've already created.
Well, thank you, Virgil. We also have a great team, and this is the team that is has proven itself over the years as capable of innovation, and any technology, no matter how exciting, has a finite shelf life. And it's the people who keep innovating, who keep recreating the technology, reinventing certain things. And without the team, whether it's the R&D engineers or sales support people or operations leadership, we would have been nowhere without the team. So we're very fortunate to have a strong and dedicated, very talented team. And I'm very glad that I'm part of that team myself.
Right. Well, thank you very much, Vagan.
Thank you. Thank you, Virgil. As always, good talking to you. And I look forward to next year's session.
Yeah, yeah. Face to face this time.
Yeah, absolutely.
Right. Right. Well, thank you very much again, Vagan. And UHP Networks, this is a company that we've been following very closely. And for all the news and information on the global satellite industry, you have www.satellitemarkets.com. And this podcast is also available on our YouTube channel, which is the Satellite Market Cast.